For illumined life to be birthed into form, I am the truth, I am the light. Illumine, beloved divine.
So, hello there, everyone, and welcome to another video sharing with me here today. I'm back in my sacred forest, as you can see, and so far it's a beautiful day. I want to talk about the goddess liberation work, which is a deepening of the things I've been talking about for quite a while here on YouTube, but not as specifically, because I went much deeper into this work on my Illumined Ascension page, my working page on Patreon. So we've been actually probably over a year now specifically moving into what spirit calls the goddess liberation work. And when I started my journey, you know, first stages of awakening and what I had to go through in these initiations of spirit, it didn't feel as intense as that part when I actually came into the realization what this work was. And you know, with each initiation, it felt like, wow, that's what I thought it was. It's even more. And it continues to be like that, actually. And so today I want to present a little bit of that in higher perspective and talk about some of the things that are part of what spirit calls the goddess liberation work. So in the previous video, I already mentioned that the goddess, the word in itself, implies the descent of life, the descent of life force, the Holy Spirit moving through variations of form. Just recently, I actually read some of more scientific and philosophical explanations of, you know, whether God truly is and why there's evil in the world. And, you know, I don't resonate with these things, you know, because a lot of them are centering around the perspective that there is no such thing as divine creator or God, right? But one of them was interesting because I don't know which philosopher, which person said that, you know, that God is not in charge of, you know, ruling over life and creation anymore once he creates, once creation comes about, and then he becomes a part of his own creation, his, hers, right? So in that narrative, we have to again remember the Trinity, a divine, you know, sourcehood, divine beingness, which is the creator, creation, and then life as it enters into that creation. So for me, that's what the narrative of Holy Spirit is. It's like life entering into every facet of what was created, what continues to be created and shall continue to be created as life continues to unravel. And for a lot of us, that's too unfathomable to even think about. It's like, wow, we can imagine this continuation of life. We can hardly move through imagining the understanding that there were previous or past lifetimes, or that they're actually in truth parallel lifetimes. So the more we go deeper into the narrative of life, it can become like, you know, discombobulating for us, which is like, you know, it's that jaw striking experience when you just don't know anymore. So when you start to have an experience of this divine nature through you, and again, it has to be always applied through the divine trinity of life, which I teach. Well, I don't teach because it's not really teaching, it's the emphasis of all life, it's the basis of all life. So you can teach it, right? You can just embody it. And I think that's why my work is so different than what I see most of the time, because it's not really work. It's just, I mean, it is, of course, don't get me wrong. You know, there's a lot of energy here behind all this, but it takes work, right? At a human level, but it's beyond just being a work. It's what I embody. It's what I, you know, what I live and experience every day. So a lot of these more psychological thinkings and philosophical teachings are about just like, you know, contemplating on the essence of life, or contemplating or the creator, which is not the same as having a direct experience. And when you start to embrace the mysticism of life, you know, I think one of the mystical teachers is Carolyn Miss. I think she's a mystical healer and also teacher, and she teaches about grace, you know, how you can't really put God in a box, like you can't put creation in this box. So just because people perceive only evil, or people perceive only something that they would say or render as this is like too limited, so there cannot be such a thing as this beautiful divine creator, And so that becomes their own experience, because that's basically how they see life. Life, if you remember, right, the narrative of creator entering its creation is creator literally becomes you. It becomes all of us. It becomes all of life, right? So once it becomes all of life, right, and when I say it, it means it's genderless, and yes, it's both gender and all gender, truly. Maybe there's more gender than, you know, what we think in our human terms, but there's a lot of what we don't know yet, right? We experience a certain aspect of creation, then we move onwards. But the experience of creation is not complete within ourselves, within these limited narratives, right? So hence, a lot of contemplation is still needed within various individuals. But for those beings who became a part of these mystical teachings, who eventually became masters of this journey of evolution that wasn't eventually anymore just about evolution, it became all about ascending the spiral of life. These beings eventually naturally become teachers, but they're not teachers in a rigid way, because they embrace life in a way that's just, it's not something you have to comply with or, you know, conform within. It's like, it's just life, right? Religion is not religion anymore. It becomes life. So how can you teach something religiously when it's just the fabric of life, right? It's the same with anything. And we're afraid of that because we would lose a lot of structures as human beings, you know, when that certainly shatters. And because a lot of people are not yet having their own personal experience, as you well know, therefore we have these regulatives and rules and regulations and what divinity is all about, and we have scriptures and prophecies. You know, a lot of the Christians are still pushing forth, especially nowadays when you see so much unraveling in our world, this game of polarity being played out truly intensely in this stage of life, at this time, in this density, in this world of duality, right? Earth 3D, it's being called, right? But it's not just that, it's beyond, it's the matrix. And yet, right, we see a certain limited narrative again. And there were many who were pushing for this for so long, right? If you push a narrative long enough and you find enough beings that have their own compliance with that, you eventually create a stream of something that a lot of energy goes towards. So that energetic eventually becomes a supportive system for life, which means if there's enough people believing in this end times and the Bible and how there will be, the mark of the beast. And again, I want to say I have never read the Bible. All I hear is through these narratives that are very mainstream and everyone nowadays knows about. So then it's also about how the Antichrist would rule the world for a certain specific amount of time, and then we would have the Savior, right? So there's always the same narrative. First you have a problem, and then you have a Savior, which nowadays we see in our world. And a lot of people don't know that the problems that exist in our planet were not a part of the human creation. They were part of otherworldly creations that became a part of this human organic system. And I will talk about this more one day. I still have a beautiful desire to create a deeper course of understanding these narratives and life force intelligence versus artificial intelligence, and, you know, agendas and so, and how to really reach that state of immunity. But as we know, if you have enough people collectively agreeing with something, complying with that, eventually it can become a reality. So even nowadays, you're watching all this playing out in the media, and all these things, like these sides and what people believe to be true. And some people believe that to be true, and some people believe the other thing to be true, right? Some people believe there's this intelligence now called Q, and it's going to save and bring all the answers, and the president will do all the work. And then there's people behind the scenes. And then there's narratives who say, well, that's just an operation, a psyop. And then there's people who don't believe in anything. And there's people who believe in Savior and say nothing is real, just Joshua the Christ. And it's interesting, right? Because we have so many controlling narratives that still push a certain something that you picked up on your journey somewhere. And as a sovereign soul, your true work of liberation comes as picking up, going back enough in so-called time, basically following the trajectory of these timelines, that you eventually find that point of inception. And I've talked about points of inception for such a long time now. And basically people are not doing that. They will choose the next best plausible scenario or resonating version. They would say that resonates with me. Maybe a few years back this resonated with me, but not so much anymore. So that's what I'm aligning with now. And a few years back they evolve a little more, and they even don't resonate with that anymore. So they dismantle a lot, you know, throughout their time and evolution. But a lot of it is still just happening within a specific framework that will only get you to reach a certain level, and then you're going to hit a wall, which I always like to talk about. Because if there is not enough organic intelligence, your own light being intelligence coming from you, whatever narrative you will adopt temporarily as your truth will keep you away from that which can be the true source of illumination for you. And many illumined beings that already had their own experience on this planet and beyond of what enlightenment is. And then for me, enlightenment and illumination are not the same, because enlightenment for me is how you first really enlighten yourself. And the work of illumination is bigger than just becoming enlightened yourself. That's what it means for me. It's like learning how to use your own state of enlightenment for the betterment and selfless service towards the work of illumination. And this is where the goddess liberation comes in, right? And what goddess liberation means is not that there is a deity somewhere up that we are worshiping, right? And it's not a woman, it's not a statue, it's not a sacred space, or these monasteries or places of sacred ritual, that have certain meaning and importance, or a certain master that's already been ascended and they represent this aspect of the goddess. Two butterflies playing here. Hello, you're so sweet. They're totally distracting me though, by the way. And it's not a planet either, right? We're worshiping certain planetary consciousness as well. We're giving them different names, right? And if we really want to do the true Illumin work and do the full goddess liberation work, it means that our physical form has to learn to resonate not within compliance, but not within any narrative that comes as an opposition, like not opposition, a proposition of something, right? But it has to become a form of natural intelligence, which is, for me, it can only be achieved by allowing ourselves to translate this direct harnessing of life force intelligence directly from spirit, which is still difficult for most people, because a lot of narratives on this planet have been written into the encoding nature, the design, not just within the matrix here, like planetary grid, but it's like the whole solar system has specific points where there is gridding that's not organic. So just today, when I made a post about, usually I do these full moon updates for lunations, but they're not focused about the moon. That's the thing. Because as you know, and not a lot of people know, and I wrote about this today, is the moon is not what we mostly think it is. And the way the moon has been encoded, the way it's modifying the signals coming through, and it's supposed to act as an intermediary force, so we don't have the direct sun streaming light, and behind the physical narrative of the sun, there is a spiritual sun. And that unity principle that you can receive life force directly, that's sort of been hijacked. And there's so many things people don't know. And we say, well, we're awake, and I'm awake, and I'm a goddess, and I'm a vegan, and I live this lifestyle, and all that. That's all very much beautiful, it all helps. But it's not in itself indicative of us really becoming illumined, because your cognition, that's what I talk about, illumined cognition has to come first. Then eventually you're going to start doing the body work. And the goddess means all aspects of us have to be liberated. That's why I talk about three main channels, which is the crown, the heart, and the root, the womb portal. And these were all hijacked. I know none of the people want to hear about that, because they all think just by being aware and focused on love and your heart, everything will naturally be solved. And you don't have to think so much about dark narratives or agendas and all that. The thing is that there's still channels of life force that have been, with immense obstruction, hijacked. So I've been doing a lot of this work lately, and specifically in the last 2 years or so. The last year was, most intense for me. Since last spring, it was like a roller coaster ride. It's just one thing after the other. And it was like these challenges were presented on my path through which I had to use all of my knowing of what life truly is and becoming, like merging with that aspect of life, so that aspect could be fully liberated. And each time there's a new challenge, and when I feel like, oh, I'm just right before a major breakthrough, I'm gonna feel very much like something wants to dismantle within me. I'm gonna feel that anxious feeling, and I'm gonna feel like frustrated and restricted, and sometimes even trapped, like in a prison in my own body, or with the circumstances or the outside conditions. And then eventually there's gonna be like this powerful force that will want to be liberated through me. I'm gonna have to find a way what aspect of life now through me wants to be liberated. And illumined beings, we actually do this kind of work. We're not just oh, we're focusing on enlightenment and being always in the flow and being enlightened. No, we're using the light of illumination to bring that light into the most distorted aspects of this creation that life has ever witnessed. Because whether we want to see or hear or not, or whether we want to face this current condition or not, it is what it is. So you can pretend it doesn't happen, it doesn't exist. It's still going to be there, like working either from behind the scenes or somewhere in the back here. And a lot of why we haven't received the purity of life force constant translation directly is because there was an infiltration of these channels, first within our body, so that our light body intelligence couldn't come through directly, because we're all unified beings, we're all one. But it doesn't just serve enough to say, oh, I'm one, right? And now I'm awake because I know everything alive is connected. But we don't act this way at all times, as you well know. It's because we're still influenced in a way or more, and usually it's more. It's in infinite ways that we're still influenced and being impulsed, right, through those constructs of life instead of life itself. We're supposed to receive directly because we're all made from that which is organic. We're made from this beautiful divine intelligence. But there's been a lot of operatives, a lot of intense intelligences, because it's like when intelligence becomes nothing but pure mind, it like grows in itself. It's like you can imagine it like a giant computer brain, but eventually it's like it's even just a box. I'm guided once again back because I watched this video once and they refer to a specific Star Trek episode. I don't know whether it was, I think it was called The Return of the Archons, and I was really interested because of the title. And Gene Roddenberry, who was the, you know, original creator, he was, you know, he knew or received or channeled a lot of things. I don't know, because I obviously don't know him. But there was, you know, they were trying to find this because everyone in that place or village were like robotically repeating same structures, or they were like following a certain narratives of life. And it was like everything was in this matrix, in this bubble, which is what we see now a lot in our world. And they had to trace this source, and eventually they traced it back to this computer, which was like a leftover of that intelligence, like still repeating in themselves. And they had to kind of find a solution how to basically dismantle that program, because just pure intelligence was like nothing but one mind, like so many animals here today just have constant noise. But it's not worth the organic way of what the goddess represents. So why in the many cultures and traditions, as you know, the goddess was presented as a beautiful woman, and we still see it like that in the statue? And why now in our patriarchal, but not just patriarchal, isn't just about focus on the masculine energy, it's about focusing on the darkness and the covert mechanisms that will hide the feminine, which is not the woman itself, but the giving of life principle. That's where they're throwing it away from everywhere. And even when you see powerful female in positions, sometimes they're not even women. As you know, there's ways to change gender nowadays. And when it's coming from very, very dark forces, that's what they do. Because like one of my friends recently stated, he said they absolutely detest women being in power and empowered. And, you know, it goes back to Babylonian times and even way back. So, the woman in power doesn't mean now you're more awake than everyone else, but your life-giving abilities have become pure. You were liberated from all these forces of inception, of interjection, hoaxes, spells, not just that, but there's much, much more. There's so much programming that, you know, when you start doing this work and you always think, well, this is going to be the wave that will end this journey for me. I'm going to start something beautiful afterwards. That's what I thought in the beginning. You know, my human aspect, because, you know, I'm a hybrid. I'm 50% human, 50% light being that has never been here before. But it's like this human self is sometimes so excited and joyful about, oh, this will finally be the wave that crushes it all. I'm finally going to be there at the precipice, and this goddess liberation work will be complete. And then the next wave comes in, and again and again. And sometimes I'm so devastated because it's been depleting my energetics of my body. It's taking so much of energy. It's like I've sacrificed my entire life for this journey, and my life has not been like life of others. I've been in this hermitage now for 7 years, and it's all I've been doing, but it wasn't as intense as these last 2 years, because it was just in preparation. I had to wake up enough to know what this is. I had to have a certain strength and remembrance that came gradually, because this is what has to happen in the human body, because my knowing is like intense and it's a lot for the human body, right? And so it was coming in these increments of these awakening moments. So this work, when I started doing it, it wasn't like, oh, intentionally, you know, when you decide to do a project, you start a new webpage, or, you know, you open up a business. It's like you have no choice because you've chosen it on some higher level. And when I started doing this work, it was like, what's happening? I didn't know. But then it got repetitive, and I was able to trace certain cycles, like how it's happening in my life. And it wasn't until specifically last year in the winter time when I told you that the focus was fully brought into the body, because the energetics were dismantled and we've done the channel clearing work and a lot of these things. But now they said, now it's time to liberate the body, like physically, because it's all like this interconnection, right? From this macro cell of life. I always see like the universal cell of life, for me, I see it like the Elohim family of light, like this one giant Elohim being from which all of life, like it's holding life. Like you can imagine this great light being is just like one being consisting of all the light beings that just holds life and loves life. But then, you know, you can trace it back to every cell in your body so that every cell could resonate one day. Not talking about days, we're recounting days, but eventually in our developmental stage in our evolution as being as a growing human, illuminating human, eventually could reach that state of potential when it resonates once again with the narrative of life as the holy Elohim, the breath of life, the giving of life, right? We've talked about the understanding of that you are the giver, the recipient, and the essence of life itself. That's the divine trinity, basically. But as we go about our human journey, day-to-day activities, things, situations, they're usually going to act as trigger points for a higher consciousness to awaken. I'm going to tell you a little bit how this happens for me, although, you know, those of you who've been with me last year on Patreon, those of you who are my steady, regular group of devotees, you know what I'm talking about. There were so many challenges, and still now when I think about, why would I even chose that? Like, why didn't my condition like physically change? And it wasn't about the art of, oh, I'm not able to manifest something differently. It was literally what they were showing me. You've chosen this. And I was like, no, I don't believe this. Why would someone be, as a higher intelligent being, so idiotic to choose such difficulty? Doesn't make any sense to me. And they said, that's your work. For you, this is an assignment. For you, you didn't come here to just like put your feet in the air. You know, I do sometimes that because I need to rest. So I go in my hammock for a few hours. But basically, you know, we have work. And I know, I always feel like I have work to do. Am I always on this assignment? Whether I'm outside or indoors, it's just like always an assignment. It just changes variations, right? But it's become so intense at times. And like I said in the previous video, I would like not to use that word so much anymore, but it's what my life has been. And it hasn't been any steady breaks. It was like constant. And this is why the human self, the human counterpart, the body sometimes feels so neglected and feels like I've done so much. I've offered myself as this body to be a result, a product of this work and this to be done through deliverance through me. And all I've gotten was this difficulty. No thanks. You know, thanks a lot. You know, I always say when I come back and my light team asks me, well, how was it? And I'll just say, screw you guys. You know, thanks for nothing. But you know, it's like it's a joke. And then I see like we are starting to laugh and it's already passed, you know, on to the next one, you know, on to the next assignment. There we go. And that's how it is. And I know I feel when I feel into my being, and even when I'm, oh my gosh, it's so beautiful now. I'm sorry. Oh, these puffy things. If you can see it, like I'm looking at this wide horizon and the trees, and there's these stuff coming down the trees and all these puffy things and the leaves and the pollen. And wow, it's just like, it's like if you would imagine all that being a component of liquid light, but manifest in form, and it's dropping down. It's a beautiful moment just to record a video because the winds are sort of doing this. I'm going to eat some, right? Burning on my mouth. But anyway, there's always something fun, right? When I record in the forest, I guess. It's like people can disturb you, but other forms of life can, right? Yeah. And ants, no, what's up with that? I have to tell you an interesting story, because yesterday I was out in this pure part of nature and I brought like a swarm of ants in my apartment, and they were everywhere. And I thought we had ants, like literally, but I just brought them home. They came with me. I was like, oh, swarming life. They just like came energetically to do some sort of work there, you know, and it was really interesting. But I was thinking, because when we first moved in this apartment 7 years ago, almost, yeah, almost, few months left, it's gonna be celebration time. But I remember this apartment had ants and we were so devastated because it was so difficult to get rid of them, and we don't like to kill off things, even if it's, you know, bugs. and creatures like that. It's like, oh, we don't have any other choice because we have to get rid of them, or they just stay and live here with us forever. And so eventually this happened and we were successful because we found a natural method. And then now I bring them home and it was like this message, wow, when we first moved in, there were ants, and now I'm moving out soon, hopefully, really, in this next few months, or probably sooner, I hope. And it's like, ants are now here again, bringing their message, and it's like changing the energy around, you know, the working ants. So that was really interesting. It's just one story came out now to make it less serious. Because, you know, sometimes I just really fall into the topic because it's so meaningful to me. It's so important. So the way I see the goddess is just this pure narrative of life that is unobstructed. It's pure. It's benevolent. It's without these infiltrations and enforced stuff like energetics and matrices and components, and these channels of energy that are just causing detours of life force instead of flowing directly, like through the spiral. When I say like this, it's not a line, but like the spiral can come and penetrate directly our consciousness, that, you know, can really start coming into our body. And that's why our bodies have been having so much difficulty. And as you know, our environment is getting so toxic and poisonous as well, not just physically, but with immense radiation, as you know, and it's becoming difficult just to even exist. Feels like it's a struggle for life. When did this happen? And this is all a part of this work that I'm talking about. It's like liberating our bodies to eventually reach a state of illumination and immunity and all of that. And that's why I want to do still that course one day freely. I hope I have enough time though, you know. But it's so much now invested in this. Because as you can see, there's this struggle. First, it's like which narrative to believe, which timeline to align with. You know, what's even real? Because you'll never know what's real unless you, the divine intelligence comes directly through you, to you, into you, you know, as you, as the spiral of life. And there will always be this discombobulation and this continuation of what you're currently doing. There's always going to be little interruptions of peace and disturbances and confusion because it just hasn't been unified yet. And we're all going through this. But for me, this liberation work, at its highest level, through essence, it means you just have to merge with the specific essence, whatever it is. It can be the densest aspect, like we've been talking about in the last few videos, right? And what we consider as good versus bad. But when this final stage of this journey I've been shown is occurring, it's going to be like the body is supported in a way that will receive this, the liberation work that's been done through essence. So again, this is the topic that I'm going to be talking about on Patreon this month. I still wasn't able to, but I'm going to do it now, because each month I'm trying to do this goddess love session that's kind of like a continuation of this path. So we're aligning with that, because it's not something you just, oh, I watch one video, I don't know what's all about. Like even for me, with so much awareness and so much precision and devotion to this, it's like constant. There's still moments like when it gets like this, and all you have to do is like just keep the anchor. And particularly in this last lunation, it was so difficult. The energy was so frizzy. I don't have any other word, but it was totally disruptive, and I could barely hold my anchor even when I was outdoors and in nature. For me, it's like easier, just come, you know, instant grounding. I can anchor the energy. But this was so wobbly, and this is what I wrote about in the update on Patreon, what it's really all about, right? What this, oh, a buggy. It was a bug, right? It's a bug. It's sometimes it bugs us, and especially when you're having a lot of challenges and difficulties in the body. And this is what I'm going to be addressing as well. So do not like mistaken this work for something that's easy. And you know, I still see that narrative that the goddess is a woman who's free in her sexual energy, and she wears a floaty dress, and someone is taking pictures of her in warm tropical places usually, and oh, this goddess and that goddess, you know, it's such a tiny aspect of what this is, my beloveds. And I'm not judging anything, you know. Every experience of life is beautiful, obviously, but I'm saying there's so much more to this. And just because we wear a beautiful floaty dress and feel like a goddess in that moment, it doesn't mean that our work has been fully done. It's at least it's how it was for me, you know. So I remember when I first started, I bought like a few of these dresses that just reminded me of these higher realms and these gowns, but I wasn't even able to wear them. Just my life was getting always in between the roughness of life, you know, the challenges of life. And it was always like this, okay, next time. Okay, now I'm really gonna, you know, next time. And then like you see others doing that and you're thinking, how on earth did he even find the time? Because all I do is this work. And it's like, you know, I'm feeling like when I really do get the chance and wear the dresses and be in that floating magic, it's probably gonna be when I really do the work, like fully. Ooh, guess which bug visited? The stink bug, the green one. Ugh, see, something stinky about this moon. He came just when I was talking about the moon. So if you want to see the post or read other posts of mine, it's on Patreon. There's, remember, three levels. One is just for the written material. One is the video content. And the other is the advanced video content, which is pretty galactic and goes very deep. Those of you who are with me long enough, you know. And it's not just like this is just listening to me, that's enough. Like, everyone has to do their own research. Everyone has to connect with their own space, where they are, what they're guided to do next, because we're each in different modes at this time. We're in different aspects and parts of our embodiment here. But at the same time, we're also experiencing the same experience of life here as it is in this density. So it's that which truly connects us. And that's the human aspect of what I feel this goddess liberation work to be all about. Because you don't have such a strong dedication and devotion to this. Ugh, flew off, right? Just when I said, right, we need to do the work. He's like, oh, it's not interesting anymore. I'm off. So he flew off. So it's like, this is what it's about, right? We do it because we know it affects all of us. It affects all life. So when someone would say, oh, there is no such thing as a creator because evil still exists, that's too a limited perspective to, you know, bring it down to that fact that there is no creator just because evil still exists. It's kind of limited, you know? It's like everything in life. And then they said, well, free will doesn't resonate with me as well, because obviously it's been distorted. Well, yeah. But at the higher level, it still exists intact. It's the experience that any soul can choose. So even when you come to a planet that you would say, well, it's called a prison planet at times, and it's so intense here. And you can get stuck here for a few lifetimes or maybe even eons. But it's your sovereign choice to come here. So there is free will. And because of that, the creator lives in all of us. And I think that's the beauty. I don't see a lot of meaning in that narrative of, oh, there is source, but it's looking down on all of us. And when you pray to it, like it will give you something instantly. And if you don't or don't believe in it, you're just going to be trapped. It's not as simple. And as you know, reality is not black and white. What we choose to align with is not as easy sometimes to comprehend and say, yeah, that's this, that's that, I know. Sometimes it's a little bit like, maybe it is, maybe it's also not, maybe both things are actually in compliance with something. We're gonna go deeper, because when we don't know, it doesn't mean one thing is necessarily wrong, you know, off the bat, like right away. Sometimes it just means we need to do more research. We're not there yet to fully comprehend it. That's what illumination means. It's like really trusting life to always show you a bigger perspective. And I see still so much limited perspective. Even people who are believing in the good, believing in the awakening, say, I'm awake. There's just the beginning of what awakening is. Because once you understand what life truly is and how it functions, it's not just all about manifesting this and that for myself. It's like life wanting to manifest the biggest, purest aspect of impeccable nature and the immaculate design for itself through us. And for me, there is nothing less but that. That's why probably my journey has been so difficult, because like my narrative, my own spirit being said, we're going down all the way. Oh, shouldn't we stop here when it's going to get really difficult, because at a certain point it will? I said, no. I'm gonna go down all the way. And as a lot of light beings who are like in communication, they're telling me there were so many here who tried before and it was difficult. And you need a lot of stamina. You need so much persistence, like even when it gets super difficult. And for me, I don't think it's ever been as difficult as it is now, because last year I felt like I'm trapped in my external circumstances, you know, in the environment where I live and the things were happening around and still continue to. And I thought, well, at least I accepted that somehow. But then this year, and you know, starting last year and this year, has been all about the body and how my body is my own hindrance when it's feeling like it can no longer serve me in the right way, when it's in this intense process of, you know, this being disfigured and now going back into transfiguring itself and applying all those aspects, like all levels need to be applied for the body to be fully liberated. So the spirit life force can move purely through all channels and move into every cellular structure and the organism of life that's constantly generating itself and co-creating within life itself, right? As the essence and then becoming form. It's like feeling that feeling like, oh, I can't, like it's human body's just too much. I just want to go back home, please, you know? And they won't send you home. It's not like that. It's not like you're offended at the first trial and, you know, at first you don't succeed. Brace yourself up, pick yourself up and try again. That's one song that comes up to mind, but it is like that. And this is why life is, it's just like seeking its, it's like it's seeking its highest point of like entrance out, like emanating out, erupting out. And imagine like a volcano. It's like first it's like building up and then this tremendous force breaking free and it just erupts. That's how it feels at times. And that causes things in the body to go berserk for a while until they balance back. And this is where I am now. And I feel when I finally do come to the point of moving physically, I'm just going to need like probably a year or so to just come back into my balance, to just allow the body to now come back into the rhythm and pulse of life, like grow my hair back, you know, things like that. Like just, it's a different one now. Say hi to the camera. You know how they always play dead? You're not dead. Come on. Looks like those beings in sarcophagus, you know, in Egypt. He even looks like those colors. Oh, yeah, he fell. You gotta love the bugs, how they play dead. Oh, come on, you're not dead. He jumped. Jumped, like, out of my hand. He's like, yeah. Resuscitation of a bug. Now, I just wanted to remove it because I didn't want him to be crushed when I sit back. I don't want to crush animals, you know. So anyway, I hope this was informative. If you ever want to join my page called the Lumen Ascension Patron, that's where it's all about. That's where it's at. So I'll see you there. And if not, you know, that's it. But I want to remind you again, I wasn't able last month because it was that intense for me. Experienced it so much, you know, very traumatic what's happening in the body for me. Sometimes I'm like, what on earth? I don't even understand it anymore. And it doesn't require understanding. It just requires compassion and love. An allowance, but at certain points I'm like, I can't do it anymore, you know. So because of that, it's like extended. So this month I'm gonna publish the first introduction training program for the light body intelligence. So you're welcome to join at any time, but this will be at the third mastery level or galactic level of taking in that content. And as always, I wish you so many beautiful experiences of life, many blessings, and as always, so much love, wisdom, and buck power. See you, bye.